Welcome to Christ Online. Today, Sunday, March the 29th, the fifth Sunday of Lent. As we enter into this period of worship today, we will be looking at the practice that Jesus lifts up of loving those who persecute you, of blessing those whom he names as enemies. How do we do that? Well, Jesus says, even if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, God can do and work great things. We pray that today your life will be touched as we worship together online.
Thank you. Well, good morning and welcome to Christ Lutheran Church Online once again. It's March 29th, and I remember when I went out to the whole congregation about 2 weeks ago saying that we would suspend physical worship for the end of March. We thought surely that would be the end of it. But it seems every week in this fluid situation that it continues to become more restrictive as we go on. So I had a conference call with the church council this past week about what would this foreseeable future look like. And we laid out Holy Week, of course, will be online. Though we will have a Maundy Thursday and a Good Friday service that you can tune into at 7 o'clock on each of those nights. And of course, Easter will be online as well, which will be very strange with an empty congregation, but we'll do it because no germ can cancel Easter, right? Well, this past week, I sent out an email to the congregation about all these changes going forward with Holy Week and with worship. But we also talked about the possibility of still celebrating communion within your home. If you have any questions about that, you can certainly reach out to me. If you didn't receive the email, call the church office and we can email that over to you so you'll be up to speed with that too. We know during this time of isolation that the church still wants to remain together. And we can do that through the technology here, both in worship and perhaps communion as well. So take a look at that and let me know what you think. Let me also just say that during this time, we know that this will pass. We know there will come a time in which this sanctuary will be filled again. We know there will come a time in which the markets and economy will rebound. But I'm more concerned about the lingering effects of this virus. After they give us the green light and tell us to go back to work, go back to school, go back to church, will we? Or will we look questioningly, suspiciously, even angrily at that person next to us who sneezes? Will we no longer gather for birthdays, weddings, funerals out of fear? Will we be reluctant to give an embrace or be quick with a handshake or to sit near one another once again? You know, it's the devastating effects about being separated by this that I can only think that the devil laughs with delight in isolating, fear-based, separating us one from another. So I would suggest this. Just as we're being good Christians and good citizens by complying to the ban and the restrictions and the social distancing, when this is lifted, let us also come together, be reunited once again, and no longer let fear dictate our moves, but that trust in that holiness of God who creates the body of Christ that is connected one to another. There will come a time in which we'll be gathered here once again. And when we do, let's have a big embrace and a handshake and greet one another once again as the body of Christ. We begin with a confession. If you're home and you're worshiping with us, please stand.
You come into your kingdom, Jesus.
We gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's spend a moment in silent reflection before confessing our sins. Please join me. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always, and also with you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
O God, Father in heaven, have mercy upon us.
Your heart, O God, is grieved by every evil, every woe. Upon your cross, forsaken Son, our death is laid and peace is won.
O Son of God, Redeemer of the world, have mercy upon us.
Your arms extend, O Christ, to save from sting of death and grasp of grave. Your scars before the Father move his heart to mercy at such love.
O God, Holy Spirit, have mercy upon us.
O lavish giver, come to aid the feeble child. Your grace has made, thou make us grow and help us pray. Bring joy and comfort, come to stay.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Transform us, O God, by the renewal of our minds, that we may not be conformed to this world or seduced by human standards of success. But as true disciples, may we discern how good and pleasing it is to you for us to deny ourselves, take up the cross, and follow in the footsteps of Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. I invite you to be seated for the readings. The first lesson for today comes from the 12th chapter of Romans. Bless those who persecute you. Don't curse them. Pray that God will bless them. Be happy with those who are happy, and weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with each other. Don't be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people, and don't think you know it all. Never pay back evil with more evil. Do things in such a way that everyone can see you are honorable. Do all that you can to live in peace with everyone. Dear friends, never take revenge. Leave that to the righteous anger of God. For the scriptures say, I will take revenge, I will pay them back, says the Lord. Instead, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they're thirsty, give them something to drink. In doing this, you'll heap burning coals of shame on their heads. Don't let evil conquer you, but conquer evil by doing good. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand as you're able. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 17th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. So watch yourselves. If your brother or sister sins against you, rebuke them. And if they repent, forgive them. Even if they sin against you seven times in a day and seven times come back to you saying, I repent, you must forgive them. The apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. Jesus replied, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it will obey you. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Amen. I invite you to be seated. Dear sisters and brothers, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. How are you doing? I know that's not a typical way to begin a sermon, is it? But this is not a typical time. It's not been a typical week. So how are you doing? You know, I can speak for the other pastors as well in saying that this past week we've heard a range of responses to that question. Everything from those who say, we're doing fine, we're managing okay, to those who have felt overwhelmed and full of anxiety. I want to reiterate today that for us as pastors and as staff at Christ Lutheran, our phones are on right now. We want to hear from you. We want to hear how you're doing. We want to know how best we can walk with you through this time, how we can pray with you and for you. Wherever it is you fell on the range of responses to that question, know today you're not alone, that we are with you, and most importantly, the Lord is with you. You know, almost everybody that I've talked to this past week has also asked me, how are you doing? How is your family doing? We want to know, and I want to tell you that's meant a lot to us. Certainly a highlight this past week for our family has been welcoming a new niece into our family. My sister Whitney and her husband Joey received and gave thanks for the birth of their new daughter. They've named her Brianna Elizabeth, or Bree for short, which was the name of my sister's first childhood friend. And you know, some people have said when they've heard that, that's a tough time to have a child right now. And in some ways it is. But as I've looked at the pictures of her on my phone, I've also been thinking, you know what? Right now is the perfect time. Because in her 5-pound, 3-ounce little frame there, she is living proof that God still loves his creation, that God has not given up on his people, that God has a future and a hope for us. In some ways, I think her coming is the perfect time. And we can't wait for that day when we can hold her in our arms, when we can see her up close. But right now, she's brought us a lot of joy. But I want to be honest with you this morning. And I want to tell you that our family has also felt some of the harder emotions this past week. Frustration at events and plans that we've had to cancel, confusion about how best to serve and reach out to others, some moments of exhaustion as we've been parenting our 2 sons, trying to work from home and wondering where all this is going to lead. And you know, there's a verse that we've clung to. It's the verse from 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. It says this, "Do not believe every spirit, dear friends, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God." What do we mean by that? What's the Bible mean by that? We know that the spirit of worry is not from God. We know that the spirit of fear and shame is not from God. What we've tried to practice is welcoming those spirits that turn us to the Lord and turning away from those that whisper worry into our ears. And how do you know if a spirit is from God? Well, there's a good test for that. The spirits that are of God are those that lead us deeper into faith, into hope, and into love. Today, our Lenten practice in our sermon series called Break It Down has to do with love. Again, we chose this months ago. And not just love, but specifically loving your enemies, loving those that are difficult to love. And again, I have to be honest with you all. When I first read this and was preparing for today, I struggled initially to see how this correlated with what we're going through as a society and as a community right now. But the longer it sat with me, and I sat with it, I began to see that now's the perfect time for this. The perfect time to look and ask, how wide is our love? Again, as I've said many times before, love is more than a feeling. Love is to seek and to desire the good of others and to act on it. And not just those that love us back or that are easy to love, but also to love those who challenge us, who frustrate you, those that are sometimes most difficult to get along with. Today we're going to look at what I think is one of the most fascinating illustrations that Jesus ever used in his teaching. It's the parable of the mustard seed and the mulberry tree. But before he goes to that, Jesus says with great clarity to his disciples the kind and the quality of love that he wants those who follow him to have. Listen to how he begins this teaching. He says this: if another believer sins, rebuke that person. Then if there's repentance, forgive. Even if that person wrongs you 7 times a day and each time turns again and asks for forgiveness, you must forgive. That is, if a believer sins against you, rebuke, Jesus says. Point it out with gentleness, yes, with love, yes. Don't let it fester. Don't just sit on it. If you can, go to them. Talk with them about that. Try to be clear when that harm has taken place. And then forgive. Forgive. You know, I was trying to think, what does it take to have that kind of love? To have a heart with that quality of love to it. That if a person sins against you, not once in a day, not twice, but 7 times, you can forgive them. That you can still love them. Try to picture that scene in your mind for a moment. Someone 7 times in a day forgiving and saying sorry, forgiving and sorry. What might you think? Would you maybe question their sincerity and their repentance? Jesus seems to imply that we're not to do that, that we're to forgive. But how do we respond to them? How do we really do that? Well, we know what the world says. The world says, hold the grudge, get even, take revenge. Remember that phrase, revenge is a dish best served cold? We know that's what the world would have us do, but not Jesus. He says, forgive, which is an act of love. But again, I think if we're honest, many of us, when we hear that, our gut response is to say, really, Lord? That person? That one who doesn't seem to will my good, you want me to continuously will their good? I'm not sure it's possible for me to love like that. I mean, that's a really high level of love that you're calling me to. And it is. Jesus' first apostles, the disciples, felt the same way when Jesus taught them that. You know what their response was? Lord, increase our faith. Increase our faith. They're saying, Lord, if that's the level of love you're asking us to have, if that's the quality that our heart needs to be and the shape our heart needs to be in, we're going to need way, way more trust in the power of what you can do than what we feel like we have right now. Notice they don't say increase our strength. They don't say, Lord, increase our ability. They say, Lord, increase our faith. And what they're pointing out is that that is hard. It's extremely hard. You know what I think Jesus would say? I think he'd say, you're right. It is hard. In fact, it's so hard that you can't do it by yourself. But for God, nothing is impossible. And that's the core of the message that Jesus is going to illustrate today. That with the power of God, nothing is impossible. Even for God to make our hearts, which sometimes feel as hard as stone, to be full of love. The same power of God that's going to carry us through this time of the coronavirus. Jesus is going to illustrate that in Luke 17 today with this powerful, fascinating illustration. But before I turn to that, I want to tell you about something that happened last weekend that relates to that. Last weekend, March 22nd, I had at least 4 significant events planned. A conference I had planned to go to, a retreat on prayer we were going to host, all canceled and postponed. And so like many of you, I decided this would be a time to tackle some yard projects that I've been putting off. And the first on the list for me was this strange big vine that was growing in the back corner of our yard. And let me tell you, this vine was a monster, a beast. The vines had grown up into the trees. I don't know how long it had been there, but I decided now is the time for this to come down. So my oldest son, Zach, we went out there and began pulling these vines off the trees. We engaged in a kind of tug of war with them. We were like Tarzan swinging from the branches. That was the fun part, getting all the vines down. But then came the hard part, getting that root system out of the ground. First, I used my shovel to ply this out. Then I used the saw. Finally, I borrowed my neighbor's axe, properly sanitized the handle, of course. And then I went at this root and finally got this out. And it was a monster. The picture doesn't do it justice, but we got this root ball out so that it wouldn't grow back. But you know, as hard as that root ball was to get out, it's nothing to what Jesus refers to in this gospel for today. When Jesus tells the disciples, this is the kind of love you're to have, to forgive even the one who wrongs you seven times in a day. And they say, Lord, increase our faith. Jesus says this, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, I tell you, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Now, I'm guessing from other Bible studies you've done or sermons you've heard, you know about the mustard seed, many of you. You know that it's a minuscule seed. It's tiny. What you may not be as familiar with is what Jesus would have known and his early followers and audience would have known about this mulberry tree, also known as the sycamore tree. The mulberry tree was notorious for having a massive, gigantic root system. Supposedly, it could live up to 600 years because of that. We know it, too, from something called the Mishnah, which was a Jewish collection of oral teachings. And in the Mishnah, it says that when you plant one of these mulberry trees, you had to plant it further away from the cisterns that provided water than any other kind of tree, because these roots would just spread and wreak havoc on the cisterns that were provided for water. So you see what Jesus is saying here. He's saying if you have faith, even that's minuscule, you can say to the mulberry tree, be uprooted, and it would obey you. Not only that, he says, it will be uprooted and planted in the sea. Have you ever seen that? Have you ever known a tree to be planted in a sea? So you can imagine what Jesus' apostles would have said, Lord, that's impossible. I mean, it's impossible to uproot a mulberry tree. It's impossible to plant it in a sea. And Jesus would have said again, you're right. By yourself, you can't uproot a mulberry tree. By yourself, you can't plant a tree in the sea. And by yourself, you can't love the person who hurts you or wrongs you seven times in a single day. But everything changes when one little thing enters the equation. You know what that is? Faith. Jesus is saying today, there is tremendous, incredible power in faith. Not faith in yourself, mind you, but in faith in the one who is the Almighty. It's got to be faith in more than our own abilities, faith in more than our own know-how, our own ability to figure things out. You know, I remember hearing a story a few years back in which the great boxer Muhammad Ali was on an airplane flight. Remember those? And when he was flying on the plane, the fastened seatbelt light came on. But with this characteristic bravado, Ali decided to ignore the instruction until a flight attendant going down the aisle noticed that he hadn't done so, and she kindly asked him to comply. And again, with that characteristic ego of his, he said to her, Superman don't need no seatbelt. And she, apparently unfazed by this great boxer, said back to him, Superman don't need no airplane either. You know, if ever there was a command of Jesus that ought to make us feel less like a Superman or a Superwoman when it comes to the spiritual life, it's this one. Pray for those who hurt you. Love your enemies. Bless those who wrong you. That's hard. And if we're honest, When we hear that from Jesus, it might make many of us feel like our faith is minuscule, small, tiny. But here's the good news. Jesus is saying that even with a minuscule faith, God can work great power through that. Have there been other times this past week when your faith felt little, small? Maybe you're a small business owner or someone who's been tremendously impacted by this from a financial standpoint, and your faith has felt small. Maybe you've felt isolated or afraid as you've wondered what the course will be and how you've seen the cases rising in the news, and your faith has felt small. Maybe you've asked yourself, where is God in all of this? And your faith has felt little. You know, again and again in the Bible, particularly in the Old Testament, when God's people went through a time of crisis or calamity, those were the moments not when they dwelt on the question, is God in this, but looking to the one that they knew had promised to be with them in this. They looked not, in other words, at the quality of their own faith. They looked rather at the power of the one that they had faith in. They turned to God, the one who promised to carry them through difficult times, the one who promised to be faithful to them, the one who promises to uproot even the most difficult things in our world. Today, God has promised to uproot even the brokenness in our lives, in our relationships. The power of God can do that. So what if for this coming week, we took this practice as something that fell in the perfect time? With maybe with some of the extra free time that a few of you, some of you might have, we spent time in prayer. We asked God, Lord, help me to bless that person that is hard to be with, that's hard to love. We spent time asking God to help us to love the enemies, the people that are a challenge. So there are at least three reasons why I think Jesus calls us to that. Number one, it's a good way to test the quality of our love. Early in Matthew's gospel, Jesus says, if you love those who love you back, what credit is that to you? Even the sinners and the tax collectors do that. What I'm calling you to is a love that's not conditional, that's not based on the love you're getting in return. This is an opportunity to test the quality of our love to what he's calling us to. A second reason, it could be that as we love those whom we might view as difficult, that they're actually teaching us something about ourselves. It could be that we're in the wrong, that we have something to repent of. Think, for example, about how many people in Jesus' time viewed Jesus as their enemy. We know Jesus wasn't in the wrong. Sometimes we're called to love because that person is teaching us about ourselves and how we need to repent and grow. The third reason I want to lift up today is because by a miracle in the power of God and loving that person, sometimes God can transform that person into a friend. I think about Martin Luther King Jr., who said, love is the only force in the universe capable of transforming an enemy into a friend. Where have you seen the power and the love of God at work this past week? I've seen it in those who have set aside their normal business to make masks for healthcare workers. Pastor Tenney's wife, Sherry, is one of those people. We have another family friend who does all the letters for the Panthers jerseys and the Hornets. And so she set that aside and she's making these masks. I've seen it in my family who went out earlier this week. They took sidewalk chalk and went out to decorate driveways and sidewalks of neighbors. And they scattered sun shining and birds chirping and pictures of flowers blooming. My wife Megan told me that after they had done that, as they were making their way back to our house, our oldest son, Zach, who's 7, asked if he could stop and write a message on the sidewalk of an elderly man who lived down the street from us, someone we never have gotten to really know that well. But evidently, earlier this week, Zach had been out riding his bike, and this gentleman came out to get his mail, and he saw Zach, and with a smile, he said two words to him, "Hey, champ." But you know, that made such an impact on Zach that he asked if he could go over and write this message on the sidewalk. And you know what he wrote? He wrote, "Thank you for your love." Why do we love, why are we called to love with such great abandon, to love those even that are most difficult to love? Because it's our gratitude for the God who loved us even while we were still sinners. To know that it's possible with the power of God for us to grow in our love, because God can do it. God, theology and science both tell us, could create everything out of nothing. God can do it. God could liberate his people in slavery from the bondage they had in Egypt and take them through the wilderness to the promised land. God can do it. God could put on flesh, the infinite becoming finite when Jesus was born. God can do it. God can say to the mulberry tree through us, be uprooted, and it would obey. God can do it. God can uproot the most difficult things in our world. And we know that not so much because of this mulberry tree, but because of another tree, the tree of the cross. Because there on the cross of Christ, on the tree of Calvary, what did God do? God uprooted sin. God uprooted evil. God uprooted hatred. God uprooted death and illness. And God has promised that God will what? One day cast them into the sea to be no more. And now God reigns victorious. That's the power of God that's at work. That's the power of God that can help us to grow in love, but that also carries us through this time right now. Dear friends, don't believe every spirit, but rather test the spirits to see whether they are from God. So what if this week we ask God to root out the things in our life and in our heart that are not of him, and to fill them with the love of Christ, to help us to grow. I think about that verse, too, from Romans. Again, a reading we had chosen months ago that we heard today, where Paul says this, be joyful in hope, be patient in affliction, and be faithful in prayer. This week, we need those words, to be joyful in our hope, to stay patient as we go through a time of affliction and trial, and to continue to be faithful in prayer. Lord, we know that your power can do all things. We know that you are with us. And so together we say to you, Lord, thank you for your love. Thanks be to God. Amen.
While we are apart physically, we remain united and together in one by confessing our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. During this time of the offertory, I want to say thank you to this committed and generous congregation. As we continue during this virus time, we found that people continue to remember their church in their giving. Our commitment is to try to continue to support and pay for those hourly workers who really depend on the generous giving from the congregation. So as you enjoy the music here today, I would encourage you also to consider the gift to the church. Thank you.
Your only Son, no sin to hide, but you have sent him from your side to walk upon this guilty sod and to become a Lamb of God. Your gift of love, they crucified. They laughed and scorned him as he died. The humble king they named a fraud and sacrificed the Lamb of God. O Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the holy Lamb of God. O wash me precious blood, my Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. I was so lost, I should have died, but you have brought me to your side to be till I
Let us draw our hearts together in prayer as one. Heavenly Father, when we are harmed, when we are sinned against, our natural tendency is anger, revenge, hatred. And we pray, O Lord, that you would uproot these emotions, the spirit of anger or fear, uproot them and plant them someplace else, but not within us. The same is true also during this time, that left unchecked, the spirit of anxiety, hysteria, fear can overwhelm us. And again, Lord, it is impossible for us to uproot these spirits by themselves. So we turn to you, asking that you would increase our faith, that we would test these spirits, not from you, but to be able to return in hope and love and trust. Lord, give us these blessings, even as we are told to bless those who hurt us, to pray for our enemies, as impossible as it is for us to do, O Lord. It's only through your love for us that we can extend the same for others. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And Lord, we pray especially for those who are in harm's way. We speak about that phrase when there is a war going on, but Lord, this is similar. For those who are in harm's way, Lord, the doctors, the nurses, the therapists, the first responders, who are in very close proximity to one another, we pray for their safety. We give you thanks for their commitment. And be with them, O Lord. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, we pray for those who are sick during this time, or who are going through difficulty, or have reason to celebrate. We pray for the gift of new birth, for Whitney and Joey, for the gift of Brianna. And for those who mourn, especially the family of Nancy Tuthill, the family of Jean Ann Neal, that you would surround them with your gift of your presence and the sure and certain hope of the resurrection. And for those who need your healing touch, we pray for Lisa and Steve, for Donna, Stuart, David, for Diane and Ruth, for Vicky, for Andy and Carla, and all those that we lift up before you aloud. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And Heavenly Father, now is the time to be the church. May we let the world know that the church has never been about a building or a name or a location. The church has always been the people living out their faith. It's the one who checks on their elderly neighbor if they need anything from the store. It's the parents who are at home, caring for their children, teaching them their school lessons. It's for the ones who slow down enough during this time to spend extra time in prayer and Bible reading, meditation, and drawing closer to you. Lord, now more than ever, we need to be the church. Outside of this building, we need to live out our lives as those who trust that you have not abandoned us, that you have surrounded us with your presence, and given us the courage and strength to go out into our homes and into our neighborhoods to be the church. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. Amen. Let us stand for the final hymn. Now go in peace and be the church, living not in fear and anxiety, but living in faith and hope, and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks for joining us for worship today at Christ Online. We pray that this worship service has encouraged you, that you have felt strengthened by the Lord, and that as you go about this week, think of and pray for those people who could use a blessing of God in their life, maybe especially someone that's been difficult at times to love for you. Know that we're continuing to pray for you. God is with you, and we look forward to seeing you soon.